The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Welcome to worship this morning. It's good to see you all here. It's good to have the privilege of being able to gather together and worship the Lord our God. And we also want to say welcome to all those who are joining us from home or wherever you are tuning in. And of course, this is a Sunday that we celebrate. And with Rally Day, we begin our educational year, and we thank God for the privilege of being able to delve into the scriptures and learn more about the Lord our God. In the way of announcements, we have this month for the food pantry is designated for canned meat. And also, the Change for Change continues. I believe that continues until next Sunday. And I thank you for everything that you've done so far and all the things that you will continue to do. Are there any other announcements at this time? If not, please rise for our confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who forgives all our sin, whose mercy endures forever.
Amen.
God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Thank you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Gracious God, throughout the ages, you transform sickness into health and death into life. Open us to the power of your presence and make us a people ready to proclaim your promises to the whole world. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Amen.
The first reading is from the 35th chapter of Isaiah. Say to those who are of a fearful heart, be strong, do not fear. Here is your God. He will come with vengeance, with terrible recompense. He will come and save you. Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened and the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then the lame shall leap like a deer and the tongue of the speechless sing for joy. For waters shall break forth in the wilderness and streams in the desert. The burning sand shall become a pool, and the thirsty ground springs of water. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm 146 will be read responsively. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord, O my soul. Put not your trust in rulers, in mortals in whom there is no help.
When they renew their lusts, they
Happy are they who have the God of Jacob for their help, and whose hope is in the Lord their God. Who gives justice to those who are oppressed and food to those who hunger. The Lord sets the captives free.
The Lord opens the eyes of the blind. The Lord lifts up those who are bowed down. The Lord calls for justice.
The Lord cares for the stranger. The Lord sustains the orphan and widow, but frustrates the way of the wicked.
The Lord shall reign forever.
The second reading is from the second chapter of James. My brothers and sisters, do you, with your acts of favoritism, really believe in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ? For if a person with gold rings and in fine clothes comes into your assembly, and if a poor person in dirty clothes also comes in, and if you take notice of the one wearing the fine clothes and say, "Have a seat here, please," while to the one who is poor you say, "Stand there," or "Sit at my feet." Have you not made distinctions among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? Listen, my beloved brothers and sisters. Has not God chosen the poor in the world to be rich in faith and to be heirs of the kingdom that he has promised to those who love him? But you have dishonored the poor. Is it not the rich who oppress you? Is it not they who drag you into court? Is it not they who blaspheme the excellent name that was invoked over you? You do well if you really fulfill the royal law according to the scripture. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. But if you show partiality, you commit sin and are convicted by the law as transgressors. For whoever keeps the whole law but fails in one point has become accountable for all of it. For the one who said, "You shall not commit adultery," also said, "You shall not murder." Now, if you do not commit adultery, but if you murder, you have become a transgressor of the law. So speak and so act as those who are judged by the law of liberty. For judgment will be without mercy to anyone who has shown no mercy. Mercy triumphs over judgment. What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if you say you have faith but do not have works? Can faith save you? If a brother or sister is naked and lacks daily food, and one of you says to them, "Go in peace, keep warm and eat your fill," and yet you do not supply their bodily needs, what is the good of that? So faith by itself, if it has no works, is dead. The word of the Lord.
Gospel according to St. Mark, the 7th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus set out and went away to the region of Tyre. He entered a house and did not want anyone to know that he was there. Yet he could not escape notice. But a woman whose little daughter had an unclean spirit immediately heard about him. And she came and bowed down at his feet. Now the woman was a Gentile of Syrophoenician origin. She begged him to cast the demon out of her daughter. He said to her, "Let the children be fed first, for it is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." But she answered him, "Sir, even the dogs under the table eat the children's crumbs." Then he said to her, "For saying that, you may go. The demon has left your daughter." So she went home and found the child lying on the bed and the demon gone. Then he returned from the region of Tyre and went by a way of Sidon towards the Sea of Galilee in the region of the Decapolis. They brought to him a deaf man who had an impediment in his speech, and they begged him to lay his hand on him. He took him aside in private, away from the crowd, and put his fingers into his ears, and he spat and touched his tongue. Then looking up to heaven, he sighed and said to him, "Ephphatha," that is, "be opened." And immediately his ears were opened, his tongue was released, and he spoke plainly. Then Jesus ordered them to tell no one. But the more he ordered them, the more zealously they proclaimed it. They were astounded beyond measure, saying, "He has done everything well. He even makes the deaf to hear and the mute to speak." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
So I began by saying this is the gospel according to St. Mark, but I also could say that this is the gospel according to Good Shepherd Lutheran Church, Virginia Beach. And you'll understand later why I just said what I did. It's a peculiar thing to read in church, and when you listen to Jesus, many times you're surprised by the things that comes out of our Lord's mouth. Because even though our Lord is God in the flesh, is the Son of God, he was also completely human as well, which meant that he would get tired. And so he was looking for a place to rest. Years ago, when I served a church not too far from New York City, I always enjoyed taking the ride over to the city. And the reason was, somehow in a city of millions of people, I could completely disappear. When I went there, I was no longer pastor to anybody. I was not even Faron. I was just a face in the crowd. And for a brief moment, I could just relax and breathe and be restored. We all need that in our lives, especially when we consider that our Lord, the Son of God, even needed that time to just be, without anyone placing expectations upon you. And yet, things didn't work out too well for Jesus in that case, because that's what he was looking for. That's not what he got. A woman had a need. She knew that he was there. But there was something that was greater than her daughter's need, and that was her faith in this man from Nazareth. She knew something needed to be done, something must be done, and there was only one person who could do it. And being a Gentile, she was not shy about approaching a man that she did not know, which the Jews would be. So she boldly came to him and asked for help. And she asked, after bowing at his feet, acknowledging who he was. But then Jesus says a surprising thing. "Let the children be fed first, for it is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." And here you're going, "Okay, Lord, you just called a woman what? Really? It's harsh, and there's no way of going around how harsh it is. But there's always background into things that were done by the Jews. In seminary, I did a paper on a place called Ashkelon. While I was in Israel, I learned that so much of what Jesus said had to do with things that were right around Jesus, and you would see. For example, we've all heard separating the sheep from the goats, right? Well, in Israel, both are valuable. The sheep are valuable and the goats are valuable. You don't want to throw the goats away. But in Caesarea Philippi, they had a temple to the dancing goats. How about that? Pan, the god, was half human, half goat. So what we're talking about is people who do not believe in the one true God. Well, in Ashkelon, they found, excavated, an interesting cemetery, because the cemetery was filled with dogs. And the reason it was filled with dogs is because the Philistines actually worshipped dogs. So speaking of others like dogs is saying you don't believe in the one true God. And yet this woman did. She also noticed that what Jesus said was not a dismissal because of one word. First. Let the children be fed first, which implies that others will be fed afterward. And the word that he used actually in Greek was kunerios, which means little dogs, puppies. Now, many of the dogs in Jesus' day were scavengers. But the oldest domesticated animal we know in history are dogs. So this clever woman in her faith responded without taking offense. Think about that. She chose not to be offended. Maybe I should repeat that, because often we can do the same. You don't have to be offended at things. What she said was, yes, Lord, but even the little dogs get to feed from the crumbs that fall from the children. In other words, what she was saying is, I may be a Gentile, but I'm part of the family too. I'm one of those created by God. In here, one of the most peculiar things that caught my attention before I ever came to this place was a statue in your courtyard. A statue of Jesus cradling a lamb in his arms. And he's cradling the lamb because the lamb represents Israel. But while he's cradling that lamb, there's something trying to get his attention. And that something is a little pig looking up to the Lord. And the pig was considered unclean, just like the Gentiles. And so that pig is looking up to Jesus saying, yes, Lord, but you are my Lord too. I'm part of the family too. What a powerful statement of faith. And so for saying this, Jesus said, you can go home. The demon has left your daughter. She is well. There are many times that we may be faced with things that are difficult in our lives. Times when we may be tired, worn out, seeking rest, but somebody may still tug at us and say, I need something. Well, what do we do? Do we turn our backs? Or do we say, The Lord has put me here. And the Lord has put me here for you. And we reach down within ourselves and we do whatever we can for our neighbors. And amazingly, in that moment when we do so, the people don't only see a kind and generous person, but the people see a servant of Almighty God, an example of the love of Christ. Then Jesus continues, and it's interesting because some people think that the writer of Mark was completely confused. Because leaving the region of Tyre and going by the way of Sidon towards Galilee would say, I'm going to Greensboro, North Carolina, but I'm going by way of Albuquerque, New Mexico. It's in the opposite direction. So what actually happened is the Lord took a large loop up towards Sidon, around, down towards Galilee, on the other side of Galilee, which is the Decapolis. He took the long way around, but wound up there. And of course, this is a place where he had been before. And the last time he came, they told him, leave us. Because they didn't know what to do about a man that cast out demons from a demon-possessed man that was living in the caves. And they asked him to leave. Oddly enough, he came this time. And if you remember, he told the demoniac, the man who had the demons, wanted to jump in the boat with him and say, make me a disciple. And Jesus says, no, I have something for you to do. What I want you to do is go back to where you came from and tell everyone what God has done. Well, obviously the man did that well. Because this time when Jesus came, they didn't say leave. But instead they brought a man who was in need to him. In the problem that this man had, in Greek, mogilelos, that word appears in scriptures two times in the entire Bible. This is one of the two. If you were paying attention to the readings, you heard the other time when the prophet Isaiah is speaking of the time that God will come, where he will set everything right in his righteousness, and that those who cannot speak, those who are deaf would be healed. And those two words link Jesus as God in the flesh. And so God also heals this man, saying, be opened. Now those two words are extremely powerful. Because sometimes I think we take the word independence and go too far with it. We can become so independent that we forget that we have neighbors. That we forget that we're part of a community. That we forget that we're called upon to love one another. And so like Jesus, we're reminded with that phrase. When it comes to encountering others, when it comes to seeing others, be open. I guarantee you when you do it, it won't be you that's giving the gift only. It will also be you that is receiving the gift. And you might say, Pastor, how can you say that? Well, it's really simple. For one thing, it's in the prayer of St. Francis. For another thing, I can say, since I've been here, I've received the gift of knowing each and every one of you. I get the privilege given by God to walk with God's chosen holy people in this journey of faith. And whenever you give to people of faith, you also receive. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Please be seated. As I said, today we celebrate Rally Day, and that begins our educational part of the year. And so at this time, I would like to call forward the teachers and all those who are involved in education of the church. Baptized into the priesthood of Christ, we are called to offer ourselves in thanksgiving for what Almighty God has done and continues to do for us. It is our privilege to recognize and support those who are engaged in the work of this congregation, especially this Rally Day, those in the ministry of education. Our Lord Jesus Christ, who came among us as a servant, calls all of us to faith and a life of loving service to one another and to our neighbors. You stand before this gathered community this day as persons identified with gifts, assisting us with our ongoing faith development. We give thanks to God for your gifts, for your willingness to offer them, and for the ways you will share those gifts in the coming year. Here a reading from Romans. St. Paul writes, "Just as each of our bodies has several parts, and each part has a separate function, so all of us in union with Christ form one body. And as parts of it, we belong to each other. Our gifts differ according to the grace given us. If your gift is prophecy, then use it as your faith suggests. If administration, then use it for administration. If teaching, then use it for teaching, doing all of them cheerfully." I ask you, will you assume this ministry and the confidence that your call to do it comes from God through the Church of Christ? Will you teach in accordance with the Holy Scriptures and the confessions of the Lutheran Church?
I will, and I ask God to help me.
Will you yourself be diligent in your study of Holy Scripture, faithful in your use of the means of grace, present in worship, and attentive to your devotional and prayer life? Having offered yourself to the education ministry of this congregation, will you trust in God's care, seek to grow in love for those you teach and serve, strive for excellence in your skills, and follow our Lord's example of humble service?
I will, and I ask God to help me.
Almighty God, who has given you the gifts to serve, now also graciously give you the strength and compassion to offer them. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, source of wisdom and knowledge, thank you for these persons who you have lifted up to serve our congregation, to assist us all in our faith formation. Give to them joy and service and constant care and guidance. Help us all to study your word diligently and thus grow in your love and to be both willing students and thankful recipients of this vital and important ministry, that your name may be glorified and your will be done through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now I ask that you turn and face the congregation, that we can give thanks to God and also for your service. You may return to your seats. Please rise as we say our creed.
With the whole church, let us confess our faith.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty,
Drawn together in the power of the Holy Spirit, we pray with confidence for the church, God's good creation, and all who are in need. Kneel as you are able. Awaken in our communities of faith a spirit of radical hospitality. Encourage our churches to celebrate and embrace people of diverse backgrounds, experiences, and abilities. Deepen our commitment to ecumenical and interreligious partnerships. Hear us, O God. Bring forth water to nourish plants and animals in places suffering from drought. Renew our commitments to protect rivers, lakes, and streams, and make us good stewards of water in our homes and communities. Preserve wetlands, habitats, and the creatures that make their homes there. Hear us, O God. Inspire leaders of cities, nations, and tribes to lead us with wisdom and humility. Bring peace among peoples in conflict and strengthen global commitments to nonviolent solutions. Guide all who seek refuge from war to a safe haven. Hear us, O God. Comfort all who live with chronic illness. Surround them with your tender embrace and sustain all who provide ongoing care and support. Bring hope and healing to people struggling with addiction and nourish the spirits of all who are in recovery. Hear us, O God. Nurture in all people the gift of your creating spirit. Inspire artists and musicians, woodworkers and quilters, poets and dancers. Revive those whose artistic wells have run dry and enliven all who doubt their creative talents. Hear us, O God. Bring healing to those who are facing surgery and those who have illness. Look upon all who wait for your steadfast love. Console those who grieve and embrace those who cry out to you. Open us to the cries of those who suffer in mind, body, and spirit. Hear now our prayers spoken silently or out loud. Layman, Harold, T. Hear us, O God.
We entrust these and all our prayers to you, Holy God, in the name of your beloved child, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you. Oh, thank you. Peace. Peace be with you. Make sure. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace. Peace be with you. Oh, peace be. Oh, thank you, T. Peace. Peace. Okay. Peace be with you. Give me a hug. Peace be with you. Thank you. Let us pray. Blessed are you, O God, source of every gift, your creation.
By these gifts, in our lives, help us to serve one another in all that we need, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, O mighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the host of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Almighty and merciful God, you are most holy, and great is the majesty of your glory. You so loved the world that you gave your only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but have eternal life. We give you thanks for his coming into the world to fulfill for us your holy will and to accomplish all things for our salvation. And the night in which he was handed over, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Remembering therefore his salutary command, his life-giving passion and death, his glorious resurrection and ascension, and the promise of his coming again, we give thanks to you, O Lord God Almighty, not as we ought, but as we are able. We ask you mercifully to accept our praise and thanksgiving, and with your word and Holy Spirit, to bless us, your servants, and these, your own gifts of bread and wine, so that we and all who share in the body and blood of Christ may be filled with heavenly blessing and grace, and receiving the forgiveness of sin, may be formed to live as your holy people and be given our inheritance with all your saints. To you, O God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be all honor and glory in your holy church, now and forever. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Christ has set the table with more than enough for all. Come and eat at God's table.
Thanks be to God.
Mercy now we pray.
The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
Let us pray. Holy God, you have welcomed us to this meal and fed us with dignity at your table. Send us now to welcome others and to be at peace with one another. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen. Amen.